Good morning, Wickford. Good morning to everyone listening online to our live recording. Welcome to this session. I've entitled my message this morning, The Good Shepherd. And we find our story, the main story where we're going to read today is going to be in John chapter 9. But those of you who are familiar with the Bible, you know that the story of the Good Shepherd is found in John chapter 10, where Jesus says, I am the Good Shepherd. But the story begins in chapter 9, where we're going to read. Before we read, shall we pray first? Lord, we thank you this morning. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. Lord, we thank you that you care for each one of us. As the Good Shepherd, you know our state. You know where we are. Lord, you say it in your word, you go after the sheep. You sacrifice your life for the sheep. You lay down your life for the sheep. And we thank you, Lord, for that sacrifice you made at the cross, so that, Lord, we may find eternal life. So that, Lord, if we put our confidence in you, Lord, we will find eternal life. We thank you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to read in John chapter 9, verse 1 to 12. As he went along, he saw a man born blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, Jesus said. But this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. After saying this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. Go, he told him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was. Others said, no, he only looks like him. But he himself insisted, I am the man. How then were your eyes opened? They asked. He replied, the man they called Jesus made some mud, put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed. Then I could see. Where is this man? They asked. I don't know, he said. Thank you. So we find a man who from birth was born blind. And the Bible says this man was 40 years old. So he had been blind for 40 years. And when they saw him, the disciples raised the question to Jesus. And they said to Jesus, Lord, was this man born blind because he sinned? I don't know, how can you sin before you are born? Because he was blind from birth? Or is it his parents who sinned? So there was an assumption that it was because of sin that this man was born blind. It was because of what his parents had done or what he himself had done, which was unlikely that he would have done anything because he was born blind. But they raised a very important question, why? And this question is usually asked today. Most people ask, why are things happening to me? You might not be blind, but today you might be in a situation where things are hard, where life is difficult, where things are not changing, where your situation is hard. You are finding challenges. You are facing a mountain. You are in a situation where you are experiencing rejection, isolation, loss, pain, depression. You're feeling unloved. And you are saying, when is this going to change? This might have been going on for a long time. Maybe now you're frustrated, you are angry at life, and even angry at God and saying, why? Why God? Why me? Why is this happening to me? I guess this man, when he was growing up, he could have asked the same question. He could have been frustrated, I guess. He would have been frustrated. I guess it's not easy to be blind. He might have needed to depend on people to help him, depend maybe on people to take him even to the place where he would sit and bear, and people to take him back home. He could have been angry with his situation. He could have been depressed with this situation. But Jesus answers and says, this had nothing to do with sin. He gives us some answer to the why that the disciples raised. He said, in this case, this has nothing to do with sin. But as you and me know, that as human beings, we do sometimes make mistakes. Some of the situations we find ourselves in are to do with our actions, are to do with what we've done, are as a result of our actions, are the consequences of our actions. So we do have sometimes, we are the reason sometimes, but in this situation, the Bible doesn't give us that it was the man. It wasn't the man's fault, nor was it his parents' fault. When we go further with this story, we find Jesus talking about this man in John chapter 10, as he speaks in John chapter 10 about himself being a good shepherd, because as we know the story, this man, after they found out, if we read further down in chapter 9, we find out that the Pharisees, they didn't like that Jesus had healed this man on a Sabbath day. And they didn't like that Jesus had done this on this man. And they ended up having an argument with this man why this man believes in Jesus, why this man trusts in Jesus. And they ended up chucking this man out of the synagogue. And Jesus goes around and looks for this man, and he finds this man. And when he finds this man, he says to him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" The man says, "Yes." "Who is the Son of Man that I should believe in him?" And Jesus says, "It's me. It's me." And he says, "Lord, I believe." And he worships Jesus. Jesus is the good shepherd. He says, "I am the good shepherd," in John chapter 10, verse 11. But Jesus says, in John chapter 10, he says, "The enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy." So the other reason why sometimes things happen is because there is an enemy of our soul. There is an enemy in this world who wants to kill your life, who wants to destroy your life, who wants to steal joy, peace from you and me. That's what the Bible says. That's why the Bible says that there is an enemy. There is a devil, the Bible tells us. There is Satan, the Bible tells us. Matthew chapter 13, verse 25 tells a story where Jesus says, a farmer went to sow some seeds, and while his men were sleeping, the enemy came and he planted weeds or tares. And when they woke up in the morning, they realized it wasn't just wheat growing, but there were seeds and there were weeds growing in there. And people said to the owner, "Shall we take out the weeds?" And he says, "No, just leave it." And this story is a metaphor. The farmer is the creator, God, who created the world. And the Bible tells us from the beginning that the world was good. God created it a good world. But we know that sin came in. The enemy came in and planted weeds. So the world we live in is fallen. It's a world of sin. It's a world of darkness. And that's a reality, that we live in a fallen world. And that's why some of the things happen. That's why some of the things happen. Because the world is full of evil. I guess you don't need me to tell you that the world we live in is a world of evil. If you look around at things that human beings sometimes do, that human beings are capable of doing, we know that the world is evil. And there's an influence of evil going around. And then we go back to the story. Jesus says to the man, about this man, he says, this man is not his sin, it's not the parent's sin, but this happened. This happened that God will show his works through this man. In other words, it was an opportunity for God to show his goodness despite the difficult situation that this man was in. God wanted to use it as an opportunity for his good works. You might be in a situation today where you are feeling like, does anybody care? Does anyone see? Where is God? When will this end? It's been going on for too long. My life is in a situation where it's so difficult. I can't carry on like this. There is a man who's really an inspiration. He's an Australian evangelist and a motivational speaker. His name is Nick Vujicic. Nick Vujicic was born without limbs, so he doesn't have arms and legs. Nick says when he was growing up, he would go to his parents and ask, why? Why was I born like this? Because Nick has got a brother and a sister who are normal. And he would get frustrated. He got depressed. But one thing he says is that when he was growing up, his parents loved him the way he was. And his parents always encouraged him never to give up, to keep trying. And he says, more than that, he found out that God loved him as he was. And I just want to tell you that today God loves you as you are. God does care. Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd. I lay down my life for the sheep. Jesus cares for you. That's why he says, come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden. Take my yoke, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light, and you will find rest for your soul. God loves you. Your situation might be an opportunity. Might be an opportunity. Or might be a chance for God to show his power. I would encourage you today, don't give up. Open your heart. Give God, give Jesus the opportunity to take what you have as you are, to take that opportunity, to take that situation of yours and turn it for good. Like Joseph says about his brothers, he says, what was meant for evil, God meant it for good. What was meant for evil, God meant it for good. It might be that the enemy has meant your situation for evil, but God can mean it for good. Take a chance on God. Take a chance on Jesus, for he loves you. He cares for you. God loves you. That's why he sent his son to die on the cross for you. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God wants to give you peace. God wants to give you eternity, eternal life. But if you believe him, it's not just for now, but it's for eternity. He wants to give you everlasting life. Jesus is the good shepherd. He's coming around. He comes around and says, I'll look after my sheep. I'll look for my sheep. Today, if you hear his voice, would you not respond? Would you not respond? He loves you. He cares for you. He cares for you. I might not have any answers for all your whys. I might not know how it feels to be in your situation. I might not know how the pain you are going through is like. But on this Pentecost Sunday, I want to tell you that Jesus loves you. That's why he gave the Holy Spirit. He gave the Holy Spirit. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I'm going, but I'll give you another comforter who will come and comfort you and lead you into all truth and show you of all the things I've been saying. And that's the promise for you and for me. Today, you can experience that peace. You can experience that life that Jesus gives, not just for this life, but for life everlasting. But today, he comes to you and says, do you believe in the Son of Man? Do you believe in the Son of Man? This man says, yes, I believe, Lord. And you as well. You can take a chance today on God and say, I believe. I believe. I believe. He cares for you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you with an everlasting life. God bless. Amen.